Hello, and welcome to the session in which we would look at account receivable. But first, we're going to look at receivables in general, then we will dive into accounts receivable in particular. This topic is covered in intermediate accounting course, and surely this topic is covered on the CPA exam. Receivable is a major topic on the exam, whether you are dealing with allowance for doubtful account, sales returns and discounts, sales allowances. You have to know receivable inside out, factoring receivable, and we're going to cover all these topics in the recordings. So what I would suggest is whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, to strongly take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. If you're studying for your CPA exam, I don't replace your CPA review course. I'm a useful addition to your CPA review course. I add explanation. I add the theory behind the concept. This way you can understand the material better. This way you can understand your CPA review course better. Your risk is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. If not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university is doing on the CPA exam. This is a catalog of all my accounting courses, advanced accounting, intermediate, managerial, auditing, governmental. My supplemental CPA review courses are aligned with your Becker, Wiley, Roger, Gleam, so on and so forth. So it's very easy to go back and forth. And I do have all the previously AI CPA released questions, almost 1,500 questions with detailed solution. So I strongly suggest you take a look at my website. If you have not connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation. Like this recording, share it with other, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So what are receivables? What are receivables in general? Well, they're claims against others. You are expecting to be paid something from others. Usually we're going to be dealing with customers, but the point I want to illustrate in the first slide is receivable could be claim against other people. Usually, it doesn't have to be only customers. It could be a claim against the government, a claim against someone that you lent money to. So it doesn't have to be receivables, but we're going to be dealing with receivables mainly. Claim against others for money, goods, or services. So either they have to pay you back the money, they have to provide you goods, or they have to provide you some service. Receivables could be current or non-current. In this session, we're going to be focusing solely on account receivable. Therefore, we're going to be dealing with current receivables. We could have receivables that are non-current as well. And we can break our receivables into two types. We have trade, and obviously, if it's trade, it's going to be non-trade, the second one. Under trade receivable, we have accounts receivable, and we have notes receivable. Now, why do we call them trade? And specifically, we're going to be focusing on this session here, accounts receivable. In a separate recording, we have to focus on notes receivable. It's as important as accounts receivable. So those two, they come about as a result of selling goods and services or lending money as part of your operation. Therefore, they are part of your trade. Now, we could also have non-trade receivables, which is we don't really cover in depth, but there's not much to them. Like if you have a tax refund claims, you had a dispute with the government, or you filed your return and you're waiting for a refund. That refund is a receivable. You're waiting to be paid your back taxes. Guess what? Well, you're paid, waiting to be paid, it's a receivable. It's not a trade receivable, it's a non-trade receivable. You could have interest and dividend. You earned some interest at the bank, but they have not paid you yet. You have some dividend coming. You did not receive them yet. Those are non-trade receivable. Advance to employees. You gave your employees. You advanced them some money. Guess what? You're going to deduct them from their salaries. That's a receivable for you. If you have a subsidiaries, well, you lend them money. Then they pay you back. It's not really a receivable. It's basically a loan. Advance is basically a loan to a subsidiary. It's not part of your operation. It's to help the other company, which is most likely it's related to you if it's subsidiaries. Also, you could have receivables such as deposit paid as guarantee of performance. Sometimes you pay money to guarantee a performance, then they give you that money back. It's going to come back to you. Or payment to cover potential damages. Same concept. So you could have trade and non-trade. Our focus is trade. Specifically, our focus is account receivable. And account receivable is always almost current. It means you want to be paid within 30 days or within 60 days or within 90 days. It's always less than a year. Account receivable recognition, how does it work? It works when we sell something on credit. For example, Adam sold merchandise on credit to Ryan, sold a transformer worth $100. So Ryan will debit account receivable for $100. Adam will debit account receivable for $100 and will credit sales revenue for $100. Okay? So what happened is this. We have a sales transaction. Okay? And this is how account receivable comes to life. It comes to life. So this is the first step in the life of a receivable. Well, Adam sold something. Adam has the right for the payment. There's a revenue process here. Adam passes the title, gave that transformer to Ryan, or they gave them the actual transformer. Here they're giving them the actual transformer. You know, it's a small toy. Adam no longer has any significant risk and reward in the ownership. They fully transfer it. And Ryan has accepted the transformer. Therefore, what happened here if we have a sale? So the account receivable comes about from a revenue recognition perspective. Once we recognize the revenue, there is an account receivable. Okay, so it arises as part of the revenue arrangement. It's when you satisfy your performance obligation, whatever that performance obligation happens to be, you transfer the goods and the services. Now, it's very important to understand how account receivable is initially recorded. What's the initial valuation? Well, we have to look at the consideration received. What are we expecting to receive in consideration, in compensation for that? Okay, so consideration expected to be received, which is the transaction price from the customer in exchange for those goods and services. What do you expect to receive in return? Okay, now there are variable consideration that goes into that initial valuation. What are some variable consideration? We could have trade discounts. We could have sales or cash discount. We could have sales returns and allowances. We could have the time value of money factor. So we have to take those variable consideration into account. We're going to discuss each one of them separately using examples when necessary to illustrate the point. But simply put, account receivable comes to life as a result of a sale, usually. Not usually, account receivable as a result of a sale. And I showed you Adam sold a transformer to Ryan. We have an account receivable. First is trade discount. What is a trade discount? You have to understand what it is. It's a volume or quantity discount. For example, if we have an item, the regular price of one unit is $100, okay, then the company says, if you purchase 1,000 units, we'll give you a discount of 20%. So notice, usually it's $100 in the catalog, but they tell you, buy 1,000, we'll give you a 20% discount. Now, when the company sells let's assume they sold a batch of 1,000, it means they sold each unit for $80, you would record the sale at the discount price of $80. So simply put, you would ignore the trade discount. Not much to it. The trade discount, there's not much to it. Simply put, trade discount is ignored. We sold something for $80. Although we said the list price is $100, we gave you a trade discount, you ignore all of that. How much did we sell it for? We sold it for $80. So that's the first thing we have to discuss is a trade discount. It's pretty much nothing. It's basically a non-case. You just want to be aware, if you're taking your exam or the CPA exam, to ignore the trade discount. We don't take it into account. We don't say that we had the item in the catalog for $100. Then when we sold it for $80. So we're going to record it first at $100 and discount it to $80. We don't. We sold it at $80. This is what we record. The second issue we have to deal with is sales or cash discount. That's 2 of 4. What is a discount? What is a cash discount or sales discount? Basically, a discount, it means a reduction in price is giving to incentivize, to encourage customers to pay early. Why? Because we want the cash. We want to pay our employees. We want to pay our suppliers. We want to operate the business. We need that cash. So one way to incentivize them, we'll tell them, look, we'll give you some sort of a discount. For example, discounts are listed something like this, 2/10 and 30. It means, Here's what it means. It means you have 30 days to pay. Okay, this is called the credit period. 30 days is the credit period. Okay, you have 30 days to pay. Credit, I'm going to call this credit period. Then if you pay within 10 days, this is day 10, we're going to give you 2% off. This is called the discount period. So we'll give you 2% off if you pay within 10 days within the discount period. Nothing is giving, and the amount is due in 30 days. So there is a variable consideration. What's gonna happen is it's gonna affect how much is your account receivable or sales at the end of the day. Okay, let's take a look at an example. On June 3rd, Arab company sold to Ryan company merchandise for 3,000. They gave them 2/10 and 60. They gave them 60 days to pay. However, if you pay within 10 days, we'll give you 2% of the bill. So we're going to prepare the journal entries using what we call both the gross method and the net method. What's the difference between the gross method and the net method? The gross method is we record the whole 3,000 initially, and we wait until to see what's going to happen with the discount. Under the net method, we record the transaction initially at the net amount. We assume that the customer will take the discount. And at the end of the day, it doesn't make a difference, the net, but we have to know both. So let's start with the gross method. We sold something for 3,000, debit account receivable, credit sales, and Ryan now owes us $3,000. Now Ryan's gonna pay within the discount period. Ryan pays us on June 12th, which is before June 13th, 10 days within that. Ryan will only have to pay $2,960. Why? Because if we take 3,000 times 0.98, Ryan's going to pay only 98% of his bill because we gave them 2% off. Or you can take 3,000 times 2% is $60. Then he's going to pay us $60 less than 3,000. So we would remove Ryan's account for the full 3,000. Notice we credit account receivable for 3,000. And simply put, account receivable is gone. We debit cash, $29.60, and we debit sales discount. You have to understand sales discount is a contra revenue account. It has a debit balance. It's a debit balance. It's a contra revenue. It's listed on the income statement as a reduction in revenue. This is the gross method. Now, let's take a look at the net method. Under the net method, we assume that Ryan will take the discount. Therefore, we would record the transaction as account receivable from Ryan, $29.40, sales revenue, $29.40. We assume that's going to happen. If that happened, indeed, great. We debit cash, $29.40, credit account receivable, Ryan, $29.40. Account receivable is simply gone. All that we have is debit cash, credit sales revenue. So what happened if Ryan does not take advantage of the discount? Well, if that's the case, we're going to have something called sales discounts forfeited. And it looks something like this. So if Ryan does not pay by June 13th, they paid July 29th, they'll have to pay us $3,000. Okay, we'll take it. We would remove his account at $29.40 because we assume the net method. Therefore, we have to remove the account at $29.40. And the difference is $60. It's called sales discount forfeited. Basically, sales discount forfeited is like other revenue. Okay, we thought we're going to only receive $29.40. We end up receiving $3,000. That extra $60 is basically other revenue. Now, why is it important to keep track of this amount, sales discount forfeited? Because you want to see if your customers are taking advantage of your discount. If they're not, you want to kind of say, what should I do? Should I increase my discount from 2 to 3%? Should I move the period to 30 days? Should I defer it to 90 days? What's going on? If that might give you some indication of what's happening with your sales discount. But definitely sales or cash discounts is a variable consideration because it does make a difference of how much you would receive at the end of the day. The third item that we have to be concerned about when it comes to account receivable is something called sales returns and allowances. What is sales returns and allowances? Basically, sales return, we should all be familiar with that concept, is when we have the right to return the merchandise due to the wrong color, wrong size, we're not happy with it, it's defective, whatever the reason is, we return the merchandise. Sales allowance is a little bit different. You could have received the wrong product or the wrong size or the wrong color. You would call the shipper and the seller and tell them, look, I'm not happy with this. They would say, okay, keep it. If you keep it, don't return it. We'll give you a price reduction. We'll give you what they called a credit. So this is called the sales allowance. So they would reduce your account receivable. They would reduce your bill. They'll give you a credit. Okay. How do we have to account for that sales return and allowances? Well, let's look at an example. During 20X5, Adam Company sold 2 million worth of merchandise. The cost of merchandise was 60% of the selling price. Based on past experience, Adam believed 10% of sales will be returned. Okay, so first let's take a look. The selling is for 2 million worth of merchandise. The cost of sale is 60%. 60% of 2 million is 1.2 million. Let's stop right here and record the sale. Well, we debit cash. Let's assume we received cash, 2 million. Credit sales revenue, 2 million. Debit cost of goods sold, 1.2. Credit inventory, 1.2. The 1.2 coming, 60% of the sale is cost. So 60% of 2 million is 1.2 million. So that's cost of goods sold. Okay, Now, based on past experience, Adam believed 10% will be returned, and 20x5 customer returned actually 150,000 worth of merchandise. So when Adam makes a sale, it's 2 million times 10%. Adam believed 200,000 will be returned based on past experience. 10% of our sales are returned. And usually customers knows what's the return rate based on their experience from several years. They would know for every $1 million, there's 2% or 1% return, or 3 or 4 or whatever that percentage is. Now the company can book the 2 million now, or they can wait till the end of the year to book the 2 million, to book the 200,000. Because what's going to happen between now, this is during 20X5. So they can wait till the end to see what happened. But they know based on these sales, there should be $200,000 return. Well, during the year, during 20X5, customer returned 150,000 worth of merchandise. Well, we debit sales return, which is a contra revenue. Just like sales discount, contra revenue, it's reducing our sales. Therefore, on the income statement, we're gonna have sales minus sales discount minus sales return. When I say discounts, discount plus usually their plus allowance. But those are contra revenues. They reduce your sales to get to net sales. They're reducing your sales. Also, since they return the merchandise, we will put back the merchandise in inventory, and we're going to assume the inventory is still in good shape. They're worth 60% of the sales. 60% of 150,000 is 90,000. So we debit inventory and reduce our cost by 90,000, because we no longer can book the sale. Therefore, the related cost has to be reduced. So this is the sales return. Okay. Now, if it was a sales allowance, the sales allowance works when you have a receivable. Okay. Because you would reduce their bill. Now, if you want to do a sales allowance, you'll have to give them back their money. You'll have to write them a check. For example, if this was a sales allowance, let's assume you told the customer, look, we know you're not happy with $150,000, but we're going to give you $10,000 back. Well, guess what? We don't need this entry. Okay. So what we do is we debit sales returns and allowances, $10,000. Credit cash, and we'll give them the money. We'll send them a check for $10,000 or a wire check. Better, they should wait. Now, not they should wait, but from the time value perspective, you want to increase the time from a cash management perspective for the customer to receive the money. So this is the entry. But here we're dealing with the sales return. Now remember, our initial estimate was $200,000, and so far during the year, customer return 150,000. It means we still have 50,000 that could be potentially be returned, but not now. It's the end of the year now. So what do we do at the end of the year? We prepare an adjusting entry. So this is end of period, whatever that period is, the end of the year. We debit sales return again, because we need to have sales return in total for that year of 200,000, which we just did. We credit refund liability. We say, guess what? And down the road, we're going to have to pay an additional $50,000 to our customers. So we create a liability. Then we debit an inventory estimated return account, which is an asset. It's like an inventory account, but it's not listed with inventory. This is the amount we anticipate to receive back from customers. So it's not, we don't put it part. It is inventory estimated return. It is an asset, but it's listed separately. So it's a different asset. Because you want to know how much you are expected to receive in return. That's an important number. This way you could also have a control over your inventory, better control over your inventory. And you credit and you reduce cost of goods sold. Now, when the customer comes back and they actually return the 30,000 worth of merchandise, we're gonna debit. This should be 50,000, sorry. This is 50,000. Inventory is 30 and 30. Okay, so when they actually return the inventory, we're going to issue them a check for 50,000. We're going to debit refund liability. Therefore, the refund liability is gone, and we're going to credit cash, because we're going to give them a cash of 50,000. Now we're going to put the inventory back on the books. The inventory for us is 30,000. Therefore, we debit inventory 30,000, and we remove this estimated return. Now, this, remember this, I told you the estimated return is a form of inventory, but now that inventory is gone. Now it becomes actual inventory because they did actually return the goods. So this is how it works with sales returns and allowances. Remember, refund liability is obviously a liability. Sales return is contra revenue. Inventory estimated return is an asset, specifically inventory. Inventory anticipated to be returned. However, it's listed separately. And the last item we deal with is time value of money, which is the four of the four consideration. Remember, account receivable is a future payment. So in the future, you're going to be receiving some money. You are standing here today. And what did we learn in the prior chapter when we talked about the time value of money? Every time you are receiving money in the future or paying money in the future, you have to discount it. You have to find the present value of that. And guess what? The account receivable is something you're going to be receiving into the future. Therefore, from a theoretical perspective, future receipt at payment should be recorded at the present value. Okay? So if the company expects to receive $1,000 3 months from now, it should record this amount at its present value. You have to discount it. It has to be less. Maybe it's worth $985, depending on what interest rate you used, or $980. And the difference is interest, right? The difference between the $1,000 and the discounted amount is interest. Now, from a practical perspective, from a materiality perspective, companies ignore this interest component for account receivable. It's not material. And the assumption is, since it's arising from the operating of the business, it should not be called interest. You should not account for the separate amount as interest revenue, because interest is basically, it's a non-operating business. If you're selling appliances and you're generating some interest, that's not what you do. You're selling appliances. Therefore, the interest should not be part of your core business. Okay? So companies ignore this interest component from a materiality, and because it's rising in the normal course of business. Simply put, just like trade discount, you can ignore the time value of money when it comes to receivable. So trade discount, time value of money, they're not really issues, but since from a theoretical perspective, you have to look at them, and I hope time value of money here gave you a different perspective about time value of money. Because if you're receiving $1,000, if you discount the difference will be interest revenue. Okay, but we don't account for it interest revenue. We just ignore it. Now, when it comes to notes, it's going to be totally different when it comes to notes. We'll look at that when we cover the notes receivable component. At the end of this recording, I'm going to remind you again, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, to take a look at my material, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course. I'm a useful addition. I can help you understand the material better, which in turn will help you do better on the exam. Add those 10 to 15 points to secure a passing grade along your CPA review course. I cannot do it by myself. Good luck. Study hard. The CPA is worth it. Invest in yourself.